Hello, this is the RPG Chick. Welcome to an optional episode of Pillars of Eternity. I am going to be reading the different classes, races, subclasses, subraces, all that stuff. Probably not going to be reading about the weapons so much, but as far as the spells, yeah, the spells for my class I'll read. The reason I decided to make this into an optional episode is because some people don't want me to hear like everything under the sun. I would have made the character creation screen probably about an hour and a half long. So. Anyway. Okay. So I read about females. A woman's role in Eora is largely dependent on where she is from. In the Aedir Empire, Valian Republics, and the Deerwood, women occupy many domestic, educational, and organizational roles. They are the primary hunters, soldiers, and leaders of the tribes of Nasitak. In Ir Glanfath and Ixumatil, women and men have more fluid social roles. In all societies, there are exceptions to the rule, and women can be found in a wide variety of stations and professions. The place of men in society varies from culture to culture. Cultures like Aedir and the Deerwood place them at the forefront of military politics and heavy labor. Among the tribes of Nasitak, men perform many of the homesteading and organizational duties. In Ir Glanfath and Ixumatil, men and women have more fluid social roles. In all societies, there are exceptions to the rule, and men can be found in a wide variety of stations and professions. No idea if I'm reading some of these names of locations and cultures correctly. Okay, so humans, commonly called folk, are the most common race in the Deerwood, the Aedir Empire, Old Valia, and the Valian Republics, though not as large as the towering Omawa, I think. Humans are well known for their strength and willpower. Now we have different folk. Meadow folk. I like the hair. The most common humans in the Deerwood, the meadow folk, or Thirtan, have lived in that area for almost 2,000 years. Meadow folk traditionally live at the edges of elven forests working the open plains, hence their name. Most humans in the Deerwood are Thirtan. Fighting spirit, once per encounter, 5 seconds after being reduced below 50% endurance, folk temporarily gain bonuses to accuracy and damage. Ocean folk, Kalbandra, originated near the equator on the other side of the globe and are currently the most widespread human group in that region, but they have also migrated to the far reaches of the world. Ocean folk are the dominant culture in the Valian Republics and are also common in the Deerwood. Fighting spirit, once per encounter, 5 seconds after being reduced below 50% endurance, folk temporarily gain bonuses to accuracy and damage. I think it's for all. Yeah, I'm not going to read that one. Savannah folk, Natlan, come originally from just south of the equator and, with the exception of some groups that migrated north, have remained in the same location for over 10,000 years. The name Natlan literally means original. While quite common in Riad Saras, Savannah folk are not usually seen in the Deerwood and the Valian Republics. God, I love that hair. Okay. So next goes into classes. So we're going to look at Omawa. Pardon me if I'm saying it wrong. The mighty Omawa are the largest of the Kith races and are commonly found in or near oceans. Though not truly aquatic, they have an affinity for water, and many of their civilizations, such as Rawatai, are based on naval dominance. They are known for their unparalleled strength. Coastal Omawa. Viewed as a warlike race, the coastal Amawa live in a mainland region along the coasts of the Northern Hemisphere, lands they conquered by pushing Thirtan, Meadowfolk, Natlan, Savannahfolk, and Orlan communities out. Their culture is more centralized and urban than their island cousins, though both groups are involved in seafaring. Coastal Amawa are very rare in the Deerwood, but those that do make the journey usually do so as mercenaries, bodyguards, or soldiers. Towering physique. Coastal Amawa gain bonuses to defend against prone and stun effects. Island Amawa originated in the Deadfire Archipelago, 1,000 miles south of the Valian Republics. While physiologically similar to their coastal cousins, the coloration of Island Amawa is starkly different, brown and yellow, contrasting the coastal's blue and green. Though still uncommon in the Deerwood and surrounding environments, Island Amawa are more commonly encountered there than coastal Amawa, who are quite rare. When encountered around the Deerwood, they are often laborers, fishermen, or sailors. Armed to the teeth, all Island Amawa gain an additional weapon set. Dwarves. By virtue of land covered and number of colonies settled, dwarves are the most well-traveled race in the world. They are commonly found in the Deerwood, the Valian Republics, and almost any colonized land. Dwarves are known for their great strength and tenacity. Mountain dwarves, Aptapo, originated on the continent to the east of the Deerwood and have spread through the area several times. Unlike the similarly diminutive Orlans, who are frequently subjugated, the Aptapo have always directly fought back threats posed by larger kith and opted to fortify their residences rather than move on. Mountain dwarves are common in the Valian Republics, but not seen as often in the Deerwood and Rid Saras. Hale and hardy, mountain dwarves have a bonus to defend against poison and disease attacks. Boreal dwarf. Most boreal dwarves in Nutanik live on the remote southern island of Nasitak, where they share the rocky tundra and snow-covered forests with migratory pale elves and the coast-hugging ships of Amawa. Like their northern cousins, Unutanik share an instinctive love of exploration. Boreal dwarves are somewhat common in the Valian Republics, but seldom encountered in the Deerwood. Hunter's instincts. Boreal dwarves gain plus 15 accuracy against any creature of the wilder or primordial types. Elf. Elves are the dominant race in Ir Glanfath and the White that Wends, and are extremely common in the Deerwood and Adir. Elves are known for their speed and intelligence, as well as a commonly isolationist nature. Wood elves, Skelterfolk, trace their beginnings far north of present-day Adir and have migrated south throughout the forests of the continent, now covering it all the way south across to the equator. They are also believed to have migrated across the sea to Ir Glanfath. While physiologically identical to one another, wood elves from Adir are culturally different from those in Ir Glanfath and consider themselves wholly different groups. Distant advantage. Against any enemy that is more than 4 meters away, wood elves gain bonus to accuracy, deflection, and reflex. Pale elf. It is unclear exactly how long ago the pale elves, Glamfellen, came to the southern polar regions of the world, but they have lived there for at least 12,000 years based on their continuous contract with Amawa traders. They appear to be among the most stationary ethnic groups in the known world, migrating within the polar region but seldom venturing far north. They are rare in all northern lands, and most people consider them exotic, if they have seen one at all. Elemental endurance. All pale elves have increased burn and freeze damage reductions. Orlans. Orlans are the smallest of the kith races, though many cultures don't consider them to be civilized at all. Also notable for their large ears, two-toned skin, and hirsute bodies, Orlins are commonly found in Irglanfath, the Iximito Plains, and parts of the Deerwood. They are known for their mental intensity and quickness. Hearth Orlins are often found as slaves in the Riad Serras and the Valian Republics. One of the treaty terms between the Deerwood and the people of Irglanfath was the liberation of Orlin slaves, and while this has been honored, many Hearth Orlins continue to live in the Deerwood as indentured servants. Minor threat. When attacking any target that is also being targeted by a teammate, Hearth Orlins convert some of their hits into crits. Pretty handy. Wild Orlins are the original Orlins who lived in the deepest forests and jungles between the tropics. While they have only been significantly separated from Hearth Orlins for 1,000 years, a few genetic differences have appeared rapidly, most notably a lack of facial hair in the Hearth Orlin branch. Wild Orlins are common in the deep reaches of Irglanfath. Unlike their Hearth Orlin brethren, they are not often seen in the Deerwood, Riad Serras, or the Valian Republics. Defiant Resolve. After being subjugated to a will attack, Wild Orlins temporarily gain a bonus to all defenses. That's funky looking. And Godlike. The Godlike are the children of the Kith civilized races, who have been blessed with physical aspects associated with the gods, though some do not consider it a blessing. These aspects may take many forms and often come with mystical powers. Aberrant head shapes are typical, and godlike are unable to wear protective headgear as it is near impossible to find anything that fits. Because of their unusual nature and their inability to reproduce, godlike are often viewed with fear and wonder. Death godlike. Death godlike are the most distrusted of their kind. Strange growths cover their eyes, or in some cases, entire face, giving them a sinister appearance. The growths are transparent for the godlike, but opaque from the outside, hiding their features. Death godlike are commonly killed at birth because many cultures consider them to be harbingers of doom. Death's Usher. When death godlike attack an enemy with 25% or less endurance, their damage is increased. Fire godlike. The bodies of fire godlike often resemble hot metal, burnt wood, or stone, with harmless flames that erupt from the cracks in their skin. Fire godlike are objects of both reverence and fear in the Deadfire Archipelago. Many locals believe they have the power to awaken volcanoes, or that killing one will cause a volcano to awaken. In the Deerwood, fire godlike are often seen as a sign of the blessing of Magrin, goddess of war and fire. Battle Forged. When reduced below 50% endurance, fire godlike glow like metal in a forge, gaining damage reduction and doing a small amount of fire damage to any creature who hits them in melee. Moon godlike are the most tolerated of the godlike. While their skin tone and a large moon-like growth on their foreheads may be strange to some, their appearances are generally considered more palatable by the other Keth. Sailors have many beliefs about moon godlike and their propensity to bring luck, though there is little agreement as to what kind of luck they tend to bring. Silver Tide. Every encounter, when reduced below 75%, 50%, and 25% endurance, moon godlike generate waves of healing moonlight that restore endurance to them and their allies. Nature godlike. Nature godlike appear to be a fusion of human and animal features, often covered by plants, moss, or fungi. This has led to the common stigma that they are diseased, and many are killed at birth because of it. Many druidic orders have a keen interest in nature godlike because of their general curiosity as to how souls occupy animals, plants, and stones. Wellspring of Life grants a bonus to might, constitution, and dexterity when endurance is below 50%. Alright, let me just see. Human. Okay, here's the classes. Barbarian. Brutes. Madmen. Berserkers. Though city-dwelling people often use the term barbarian with a dose of disrespect, these rural warriors are respected by their communities for their ferocity and fearsome presence on the battlefield. Barbarians have a special, almost religious role in some cultures, but in many places, the undisciplined, fearless style of the barbarian is simply how warriors conduct themselves. Starting ability, Carnage. When barbarians hit with melee attacks, they automatically make reduced damage attacks at all other enemies within a short distance of the target. Subclass of barbarian. Okay, I guess we don't have subclasses for these. Cipher. A recent discovery in the Eastern Reach, ciphers were once called Brishalguin, mine hunters, by the Glamfellens. Ciphers have the ability to directly contact and manipulate another person's soul and psyche, using an ally's or enemy's essence as the focus for their magic. Though most ciphers are still found in the Eastern Reach, practitioners of the techniques have spread throughout the known world. They are gaining acceptance over time, but are generally distrusted, especially by the uneducated. Ciphers can directly target allies and enemies with powerful soul-focused effects. These powers cost focus, which ciphers build through the use of their soul whip. Fighters form the front line of disciplined armies across the Eastern Reach, though they are most commonly found in cultures with an organized martial structure. Fighters can also be encountered as wandering mercenaries, bodyguards, and other types of sellswords. The common element that unifies fighters is their heavy focus on endurance and melee defense. Starting ability, Constant Recovery. Fighters continually regenerate endurance at a modest rate during combat. Paladins are martial zealots devoted to a god, a ruler, or even a way of life. They can be found in any culture where a fanatical group of like-minded individuals have formed a warrior society dedicated to advancing their cause. Among those aligned to their worldview, paladins are viewed with respect and admiration, if a bit of fear. Many paladins hold leadership positions in armies and mercenary companies, but in the heat of battle, their fanaticism often overrules the chain of command and common sense. Starting ability, Faith and Conviction. Paladins have an inherent bonus to all of their defenses. Over the course of the game, the value of this bonus may shift depending on the reputations the paladin gains relative to the behaviors that are preferred by his or her order. Okay, here we have different paladin orders. Bleak Walkers. The Bleak Walkers are soldiers dedicated to conducting warfare mercilessly and with extreme brutality in order to bring a swift end to conflicts. Because they are renowned for their terrible and unyielding nature, most nobles will only call on them as a last resort. The Bleak Walkers' behavior reinforces cruelty because the quickest resolution to a battle is one in which the Bleak Walkers' arrival is announced and a surrender immediately follows. To ensure that people understand that no mercy will be given by Bleak Walkers, they never give quarter under any circumstances. Favored dispositions, cruel, aggressive. Disfavored dispositions, benevolent, diplomatic. Get a drink here. Darkozy Paladini? The oldest known paladin order in the world, the Darkozy Paladini, were founded as the guards of the Darkozy Palace in the Granvalia over 2,000 years ago. Since the shattering of Granvalia, the Darkozy Paladini have transformed into the protectors and ambassadors of the immense Darkozy family, as well as old Valian culture. The Darkozy Paladini are widespread and occasionally even come into conflict with each other due to the machinations of the Darkozy family, Paladins of the Order are renowned for their wit and love of life. Favored dispositions, passionate, clever. Disfavored, cruel, stoic. The Gold Pack Knights are an order of mercenary paladins who sell themselves for all sorts of defensive and offensive engagements. They emerged on the Pearl Coast a few hundred years ago and managed to survive the destruction of the Golden Nation that created them. Gold Pack Knights are not especially brutal and are willing to shift direction based on the desires of their employers. As their name suggests, the Gold Pack Knights believe payment forms a binding contract. They are known for being non-judgmental, professional, and impressively mirthless. Favorite dispositions? Stoic, rational. Disfavored, passionate, aggressive. Some more stats. Kind Wayfarers. The most widespread paladin order, the Kind Wayfarers are guides and protectors for travelers, often people of limited means traveling in dangerous areas. Kind Wayfarers lack the noble prestige of other paladin orders, but are widely respected by commoners for their generosity and compassion. Kind Wayfarers lack a centralized structure and many members operate independently in remote areas. Though the order is known for not being wealthy, in recent years they've impressed their finances via cartography and working with groups like the Hand Occult to develop travel guides for little-known parts of Eora. Favorite dispositions? Benevolent, passionate. Disfavored, deceptive, cruel. Shieldbearers of St. Elega. During a peace negotiation, an archer from the Kingdom of Adir shot the noblewoman emissary of Culkin, Elka. It's Elka. In the arm, provoking battle. Elka nevertheless made a second attempt at negotiation, accompanied by three elven knights whose only arms were shields they held in front of Elka to protect her. Elka succeeded, helping form the Adir Empire. The knights who protected her founded the Shieldbearers of St. Elka, who continue to act as guardians and diplomats in Adir and beyond. They are well known for their honesty and skill in negotiations. Favorite dispositions, honest, diplomatic, disfavored, cruel, aggressive. Okay, so there's nothing else there, okay. Ranger. Rangers are warriors of the woodlands and masters of the hunt. Always partnered with soul-bonded animal companions, they can be found in wild spaces all over the world. As their lifestyles often tend towards independence and isolation, it is rare for rangers to become an integral part of a large fighting force, though they are often employed as scouts and guides. Starting ability, animal companion. All rangers share a strong bond with an animal companion. The companion fights at the ranger's command and is extremely valuable for its ability to run interference. Animal companions don't do much damage, but they have high damage reduction. The link between the ranger and companion is powerful. If one goes down in battle, the other suffers as well. Wizard. The masters of academic magic. Wizards are students of arcane traditions that stretch back beyond the boundaries of recorded history. Wizards are a highly organized group, often forming academies or guilds devoted to research and development in magical studies, and tend to favor environments where inquiry, experimentation, debate, and the dissemination of knowledge are encouraged. Many accomplished wizards eventually become known for their eccentricity, their egos, and their unquenchable interest in all things arcane and occult. Starting abilities. Arcane Assault. Mid-range attack that hits a small area for raw damage and can leave targets dazed. Spells. Wizards have access to a variety of offensive and personal defense spells. Unlike priests and druids, wizards learn individual spells that they store in and cast directly from their grimoires. Grimoires can only hold 4 spells of each spell level, which motivates wizards to keep multiple grimoires for different needs. Every two levels, wizards gain access to an additional set of spells. However, they can automatically learn one spell of any level they can access each time they advance. Wizards also have the option of learning spells from grimoires they find or buy. Initially, their spells can be cast a limited number of times per rest. As wizards gain power, their weaker spells eventually drift to per-encounter use. Chanter. In every culture across Eora, there are chanters. Many historians consider chanters to be the most ancient workers of magic, their hallowed phrases stirring the collective memory of wayward souls around them, compelling them to generate magical effects in a kind of reenactment. In some societies, chanters form organized groups of storytellers and researchers, but in most parts of the world, they are just a time-honored part of local folk traditions. Starting abilities, phrases, chants. All chanters can continuously speak chants made up of magical phrases. Phrases produce passive effects can help build a chanter's power until they can use an invocation. Invocations, powerful magic effects that chanters can create after they have spoken a required number of phrases through their chants. Druid. Animists at heart, druids tap into the spiritual power that flows through the simple living things of Eora, plants, animals, and sometimes even living stone. While not necessarily religious, druids do have a reverence for the natural world and a keen interest in understanding its mysteries. In most cultures, druids are understood as a sort of primal magician, but among the Glamfellens, Nesitiki, and many rural cultures, they may have high positions of influence and authority. Starting abilities, shapeshift. All druids have mastered one animalistic form. These forms give the druid strong melee abilities and grant an additional power while the druid is shifted. Spells. Druids have access to a variety of offensive and some support-oriented spells. Every two levels, druids automatically gain access to an additional set of spells. Initially, their spells can be cast a limited number of times per rest. As druids gain power, their weaker spells eventually shift to per-encounter use. Monks belong to a variety of fighting orders that have sprung up in Ixamatil and the Eastern Reach over the past few centuries. While many monastic orders can trace their teachings to the enduring founder, Tlatak, individual organizations vary greatly in their focus, morality, and ethics. Common folk respect the incredible discipline of monks, but see them as an odd, unpredictable bunch who may not be entirely sane. Even mercenaries and other adventurers aren't sure what to make of them. Starting ability, Transcendent Suffering. When monks have no weapon equipped, their unarmed attacks are exceptionally powerful and continue to increase in damage as they gain levels. Wounds. As monks are damaged, their pain generates wounds. Wounds can be used to power many of the monks' special abilities. Priests are devotees of Eora's deities and practitioners of religious magic. While all priests dedicate themselves to specific gods, priests' power is actually derived from their personal beliefs. In contrast to most paladins, priests tend to focus on philosophy, teaching, and the relationship of religious organizations with common folk. The reception of priests in any given part of the world depends largely on how their god is revered, or reviled, by the people who live there. Starting abilities, Holy Radiance. Generates a modest amount of endurance for allies around the priest. Any enemy vessels caught in the area take burn damage and may be frightened. Over the course of the game, the power of this ability may shift based on your reputations the priest gains relative to the behaviors that are preferred by his or her deity. Spells. Priests have access to a variety of support and some offense-oriented spells. Every two levels, priests automatically gain access to an additional set of spells. Initially, their spells can be cast a limited number of times per rest. As priests gain power, their weaker spells eventually shift to per-encounter use. Okay, so these are deities. called Barath in Edirian and Serrano in Valian, it is the god of cycles, of doors, and of life and death itself. People commonly place or carve the figure of Barath in doorways, windows, and other portals from one place to another. Barath has a relatively small priesthood, in part because it does not speak often to them. However, Barath has many, many petitioners and occasional followers. Favored dispositions: stoic, rational. Disfavored: passionate, cruel. Eothes is the Edirian name for the god of light, redemption, and rebirth. While worship of Eothes is still popular in the Edir Empire in Riad Saras, the faith is outlawed in most cities of the Deerwood due to events of the Saints' War, in which Saint Waedwen, who had supposedly become a living vessel for Eothes, attempted to invade the Deerwood before being destroyed at the gates of Halgrath's Citadel. Eothes has not been heard from since and is presumed dead by most. Favorite dispositions: benevolent, honest. Disfavored: cruel, deceptive. Magrin is the goddess of war and fire, and hers is the most populous following in Deerwood. Magrin's faithful are rank and file soldiers, as well as officers, tacticians, and strategists. Additionally, they create devices used in warfare, usually those made in the forge, such as weapons and armor. Her priests view battle and warfare as inevitable human activities that should be pursued with single-minded efficiency. Consequently, she is not a goddess of battle lust or celebration as much as military excellence and passionate discipline. Favorite dispositions: aggressive, clever. Disfavored: diplomatic, passionate. Skaan, known as the Quiet Slave, is the god of secret hatred, resentment, and violent rebellion. He is usually depicted as a small, bald man covered in lash scars whose ears and nose have been cut off. He appears outwardly submissive with downcast eyes. However, his eyes glitter black with quiet hatred, and his fist is clenched. He is known to manifest in a horrific incarnation known as the Effigy to followers, desperate enough to perform certain unspeakable rites. In Deerwood, Skaan's faithful often double as torturers and executioners, delighting in the fall of high-status prisoners. Favorite dispositions: deceptive, cruel. Disfavored: benevolent, aggressive. Whale is the god of dreams, secrets, mysteries, and revelations. Inscrutable even to the other gods, Whale has no determinate gender or consistent appearance. Its symbol is the eye, though the look and number of the eyes often change. People pray to Whale both to protect their secrets as well as to unravel the mysteries in front of them. Followers of Whale are known for many strange and unusual practices, possibly for good reasons, possibly for no reason at all. Favorite dispositions: deceptive, clever. Disfavored: rational, honest. Rogues are vicious killers, feared for the brutality of their attacks. They can be found as often in dark back alleys as the heart of battlefield skirmishes. Though unpredictable and undisciplined, rogues are commonly used as shock troops or as part of a surprise assault, their withering attacks breaking enemy ranks and morale. Rogues tend to congregate in larger numbers in cities where they can be steadily employed as mercenaries or hired muscle. Oops, skip there. Starting ability: Sneak Attack. Applies bonus damage to the rogue's ranged and melee weapon attacks when the target has any of the following afflictions: blinded, flanked, hobbled, paralyzed, petrified, prone, stuck, stunned, or weakened. It also applies to any target the rogue strikes with a weapon within the first 2 seconds of combat. Okay, I did want to look at this. Can't look at the others, but here's the powers of the cipher. Antipathetic field creates a toxic physical manifestation of the mutual antipathy between the cipher and the enemy target. Anyone caught in the path between the two will suffer corrosive damage. Here's the stats. I'm not going to read that. Eye strike, shocks an enemy's visual receptors, dazing and blinding them as well as nearby targets. Mind wave. Target becomes the object of a concussive blast of psychic energy, suffering raw damage from the trauma. Characters in a conical area behind the target failing a fortitude check are knocked prone from the blast. Soul shock. Briefly transform the outer shell of an ally's soul into energy, releasing an electrical burst around them. Characters standing in the area around the target take shock damage. Tenuous grasp assails the target's grasp on reality, frightening and confusing them. Whisper of Treason imparts a bedeviling secret to an enemy that causes its allegiance to bend, charming them for the duration. So I did want to look back here. Some of these areas and these civilizations. Deerwood, a colonial nation founded by settlers from the Adir Empire. Following a series of conflicts with Adir, the territory became independent in 2672 AI and is now ruled by a duke who is elected by 7 earls that oversee its earldoms. Valian Republics, excuse me, a mercantile power and former colony of a larger, more ancient nation, Old Valia. The Republics lie to the south of Deerwood and Ir Glanfath and are ruled by a duke elected by the Consuagli Esegia, a council of 14 dukes, including its 5 most prominent, the Duke's Bells. Looking for more. Here are the Rid Saris. Rid Saris. Deerwood's neighbor to the north, Rid Saris is a nation firmly rooted in its Eothasian faith, a fervor that took hold during the events of the Saints' War and remains even after the apparent death of Eothas. So let's see if we can find any more of these areas or societies. So mostly you just see these 3, Valian Republics, Deerwood, and Rid Saris. I mean, I guess as far as NAS attack and stuff, we'll just have to find that out during the game. Ir Glanfath. A territory comprised of the forest southeast of the Bale River, populated indigenously by a group of loosely affiliated tribes collectively known as Glanfathans and governed by a council of its 6 most powerful tribes. Ir Glanfath is home to a large number of ruined Ingwithin sites, which Glanfathans hold sacred. The ruins have been at the center of a number of large-scale conflicts with Deerwoodian colonists whose settlements often encroach on Glanfathan territory and who frequently seek to plunder the ruins for their relics. Just looking for any more. Excuse me, wow. That's the one I just looked at, yeah.
Hmm.
Death. On certain difficulty settings, if a character is reduced to zero health, he or she goes down and is either maimed or, if already maimed, killed. A dead character is killed outright and cannot be brought back. Magrin. Can we read about Magrin in the deity section for cleric? Goddess of war, fire, transformation, purification, consumption, and trials. Patron goddess of the Deerwood, thought to have blessed the Godhammer bomb that destroyed Wadwin and possibly Yothas. Yeah, Magrin. Okay, that's all I'm going to read. Wow, this is a pretty long episode. So yeah, 40 minutes. 41 minutes. Thanks for watching and see you in the game.